emails to you, and they are, you'll run into the other type in other states, you won't run into it in Florida. It's called a deed of trust. A lot of states use an instrument called a deed of trust, and that's what they actually call their mortgage. You'll still always sign a promissory note, but then you'll give the lender a deed of trust instead of a mortgage to secure the note. Here's what happens under a deed of trust. The borrower actually conveys his property to a third-party trustee who holds title to the property for the benefit of the lender. So if in Georgia you sign a deed of trust to the bank, you will actually sign a deed that transfers the title to Joe Blow, trustee, who holds title as trustee on behalf of the bank until the bank is paid. That's called a deed of trust. We don't do that in Florida. We don't use a deed of trust. We don't have a third-party trustee. You basically just sign a mortgage in favor of the bank. Just like you signed a promissory note in favor of the bank here, you then sign a document called a mortgage in favor of the bank.
So the mortgagor would not show up on the records then in either of these cases?
Oh yeah, the mortgagor is the borrower. He always shows up.
Okay.
The mortgagee is the lender. He would also show up because the deed of trust situation, is that what you're asking me about?
Actually, the deed of trust and the title theory.
Well, in both cases, who are you saying doesn't show up? The borrower or the lender?
Well, my reading or my understanding is that the mortgagor, the person who's borrowing the money.
That's the borrower's.
Right. Don't have the deed because the deed is in someone's name. So my question is that what's in the book at the courthouse?
Remember that the books at the courthouse, you don't just go look at some book and say, hey, there's the owner. You go examine all the instruments and then you make a professional opinion of who's the owner. There will be, in all those states, a deed to the owner. But then he will then execute in the deed of trust states an instrument that's really a mortgage, where the owner conveys to a third-party trustee on behalf of the lender the title to the property. But the owner is still the owner. The point is, in those states, they actually say title is coming out of the borrower and going to the lender. In Florida, we just have, the owner has a deed, he signs a mortgage in favor of the lender. I don't know if I'm answering your question.
Yes, you are.
If I'm not,
yes,
I'm
you
not,
are.
I'm not,
no, yeah, you are.
Okay, but for example, here, I'm sorry. We talked about, let's look at the Broward County Property Appraiser's website to see who owns the property. In all those cases where it says who the owner, it's gonna be the borrower. It's gonna be what we're calling the borrower here, the mortgagor.
Right.
Now, yes, and you've properly teed up that in a mortgage, the mortgagor is the borrower, the mortgagee is the lender. More sophisticated lenders, and you're going to see in a minute, call them the borrower and the lender, or the borrower and the bank. And the reason, again, is to try to get rid of these fictions like lessor, lessee, and vendor, vendee. Let's call them buyer, seller, let's call them landlord, tenant. Let's call them what they really are, the borrower and the lender, or the borrower and the bank. Now let's look at the first mortgage for a second that I sent you. I sent you a couple pages of a mortgage, and I just want to show you the clauses. This, I think, was a 39-page mortgage to secure this $731,000 note we looked at. So this is what you're going to record now. This first mortgage instrument that says first mortgage and security agreement is what gets recorded. You see it says who the borrower is, who the bank is, that means the lender, what the initial amount of the loan is, $731,250. You're going to see something here about future advances, and we'll talk about that later. That means the bank can loan more money if it wants to in the future under the terms of this mortgage. We'll talk about that later. Land description, see Exhibit A. We're creating a lien on a piece of real estate. Of course, just like a deed is going to have a legal description, the mortgage is going to have a legal description. This one is at the back, on, you know, it's not relevant. The point is it's going to have a legal description for the piece of land that the lien is imposed upon. Okay, now look at the bottom of the page. Last line. Borrower hereby grants, bargains, sales, assigns, transfers, and conveys to bank. Okay? If that doesn't sound like the borrower is transferring the title to the bank, I don't know what does. However, Florida says, doesn't matter. It does not convey the title to the bank. It is a mortgage, and a mortgage creates a lien, and the bank does not own it. So the last word is the one that counts, and mortgages to bank. That means that this is an instrument to secure a debt, and since it's an instrument to secure a debt,
it's a lien. What page you're on?
Page 1, first paragraph.
Bottom of page 1. Last line of the page.
Mortgage.
I'm sorry.
I don't think my page 1 was that.
Yeah. Page 1.
I'm sorry. What do you guys have for page 1? I thought for page 1, I have at the bottom paragraph traffic. 1, there are three lines of it. Did it go to the top of your page 2?
Top of page 2. I think that's probably what you're referring to.
Yeah. Okay, your page break is different from mine. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Okay.
Top of page
I'm talking
two.
About paragraph number 1.
Oh, okay. Beautiful. Top of page
top 2. Top of page 2 for yeah. you. Third yeah. line.
Yes.
Third line. Borrower hereby grants, bargains, sells, assigns, transfers, and conveys. That sounds like a conveyance, all right? That's the same word to come out of a deed.
Yeah.
But our law says it's not. It's a lien. This is the one that counts. And mortgages to bank. It's successors and assigns. We'll talk about it later. Mortgages get transferred around. Assigned and assigned and transferred. So the point is, once this mortgage is recorded, bank may transfer it. And this is where it says it's a mortgage in favor of the bank and it's assigned. Now, it says it mortgages the real estate described above as the land. Okay, so this creates a mortgage on the land together with. Now let's read a few of these together with, and I'm hopeful that as we go through this, lights are going to go off and you're going to say, I know what that is, and I know what that is, and we talked about that. Yeah, each one of these things. Let's look at what you're mortgaging to the bank. In number one, you're mortgaging all of the easements appurtenant to the land. Okay, easement appurtenant. If you have an easement appurtenant, this mortgage gives the bank a lien on it. Fourth line, and rights of ingress and egress to the land. If you got the way to get in and out of there, the bank gets a mortgage on it. Two more lines down. And the water rights and powers and the oil, gas, and mineral rights, the riparian rights, littoral rights, further, reversions and remainders. Isn't this great? You've learned all this crap already. So you know what each of these things are. All of these wonderful can't help but use the word appurtenances, all of these wonderful benefits to go with owner of the land that you own, well, the bank just got a lien on. If you own them, they just got a lien on. With sub two, of course, and all of the buildings and structures. Yeah, that's what they mostly want the lien on. So they got a mortgage on your building. And in paragraph 3, all the fixtures, next line, that are attached and affixed to the land. Yeah, we talked about that. Two more lines, regardless of whether they're physically affixed thereto or severed or capable of being severed. Remember, we attach it as a fixture. They're saying we got a lien on whether it's attached or not.
Professional.
Section 4. We got a lien on all of your rents and your issues and your profits arising in any manner from the land, including the borrower's interest in all of the leases. Of course, what's going to make the mortgage payment is the rents. So they want to lien on your rents. Paragraph 5. You give the bank all of your right and title to further encumber the property. What that means is you can't go out and get a second mortgage. You already gave up the right to get a second mortgage to the bank. If you get a second mortgage, the bank can foreclose this mortgage. At the bottom of the page, very last, I say forgive me. I'm not that's your page. Section 6. Proceed. Together with all of the cash that can come out of a taking of the property, including insurance and condemnation proceeds. If there's eminent domain and condemnation, the bank gets the money. If there's insurance proceeds paid on the insurance, the bank gets the money. They're doing their damnedest to tie you up as best they can.
So, what, so Florida doesn't do this, but other states do, that's what you said, right? Okay.
This is Florida.
Well, this is Florida?
No,
you said something about, well, is this still part of the D-Trust?
This is City National Bank of Florida. A Florida limited partnership is the borrower. I'm sorry, what gave you the idea this was somewhere else?
You said, first of all, you said two types of mortgages, then you said D-Trust, that's one. Is this
we don't use.
Right. Okay. And then, so now this is a second type of mortgage?
It's a mortgage, yeah.
Oh, is this a mortgage? Is this a regular one?
This is a mortgage.
Okay.
This is not a D-Trust.
Okay.
This is a mortgage. This is what we use in Florida.
Okay.
Florida uses mortgages, not deeds of trust. That's what I'm showing you.
Okay, okay, that's why I thought this was still a deed of trust.
Are you getting confused between the title or the lien theory?
Oh, no, I got that. I just thought the deed of trust was a continuation of that.
No, I'm sorry. We're now talking about what's in a mortgage. What is a mortgage?
Okay.
All right. Now, I'm sorry if you weren't with me there. This is a Florida mortgage encumbering Broward County, Florida real estate, with an apartment building on it with rental income. Okay. Now,
just one more question. Are they coming up with all of these clauses to tie the mortgagor's hands because of that maximum possible principal debt, including up to $3 million? Do you think that?
No, because they want to be paid. That's what this is all about. I loan you $731,000. I want it back. I want to tie up all of your property that relates to this piece of property. I don't want to tie up your car and your boat, but this piece of property that I loaned you the money probably to buy or to refinance later, I, the bank, want to be repaid. So I want to claim against your rents, I want to claim against your insurance, your eminent domain proceeds, I want your easements, I want your buildings, I want your leases, I want your every damn thing as collateral to make sure that I get my pay. Now, but they only have a lien on those things. They don't get them. And as long as you make your payments every month, everything is cool. What this is all about is, if you don't make your payments, they're going to come take all of these things away from you. Not your car and your boat, but all of these things.
Or if you make a loan for another mortgage.
If you default in any way, if you violate any of the 39 pages of provisions that have come, and we're only on page 2 right now. I want you to go over to what I have as page 3, the last paragraph before section 2, security agreement.
Paragraph 10?
Notwithstanding the grant.
Okay,
just before security agreement.
Yeah.
Second line. So long as no default shall exist here under or under any of the loan documents, borrower shall have a license to collect and receive all income from the operation, ownership, and maintenance of the property, including the rents. Interestingly though, but no more than 2 months in advance. Think about why that is. If you went out to all your tenants and said, go ahead and pay me in advance your rent for the next 3 years, and then never pay the bank again, the bank forecloses, the tenants say, don't talk to me for the next 3 years, I already paid him. So they don't want you as the owner getting everybody to prepay their rents and then walk away. But you can only collect rent up to 2 months in advance, and that's the old first, last, and security we always talk about. Okay, so here's the point. This is what a mortgage does. It creates a lien on your property and your rents and your buildings and your easements and your insurance and your anything in, because the bank wants to be repaid. Okay, that's what a mortgage does. Yeah, theoretically, the borrower's the mortgagor and the lender's the mortgagee, but more sophisticated lenders like this call them the borrower and the bank, or the borrower and the lender. Let's say what it really is. Okay, how do you get one? You go to a lender and you file a loan application,
of course.
But here's what's important. You get a commitment. That's a term of art. You need to know what a commitment is. commitment is a document where a lender approves your loan. But it's a hell of a lot more than okay, you're approved. It's a contract between the borrower and the bank. It gets negotiated just like a sales contract. The bank, you go apply to the bank for a loan. If their loan committee approves you, and we're talking about, this is a commercial mortgage, and I'm focusing on commercial mortgage. The bank sends you an 8 or 10 page long letter called a commitment letter. That's what we're talking about here. The commitment letter is the same as the commitment. And in it, the bank says stuff like, I agree to loan you $731,000 for you to purchase such and such a piece of property. And the interest rate will be Citibank Prime. And here's how long you'll have, 2.5 years to pay it back. And the payments will be interest only every month. And then, a lot of stuff. The borrower takes that, and if he's a heavyweight borrower, he starts crossing out and changing stuff, just like you do in a sales contract. He said, no. I'm not gonna pay Citibank Prime plus two. I'm just paying Citibank Prime, cross out the plus two. And their commitment comes in at $700,000. He said, nah, I want to borrow $731,000. And he goes back and forth between the bank and the borrower. Little guys sign it the way it is or leave it. Big guys negotiate a commitment letter just like you negotiate a sale contract back and forth between the bank and the borrower. But once it's been fully signed, it is a contract. It obligates the bank to loan the borrower the money. And it obligates the borrower to borrow the money from the bank. And they both sign it. And they initial all the changes. And they go one step further. Yes, sir.
Is this typically only done after a property has been an offer, or can you get this done before, assuming that certain criteria are met, like loan to value ratios and stuff like that? Or is this once you have the property,
normally,
now you gotta go get somebody?
Well, normally, There are two concepts here, and the commitment letter applies both ways. Sometimes you signed a sales contract yesterday to buy that piece of property that had a contingency in it that you had to go get a mortgage. Sometimes you already own the property. That's called a refinance if you already own the property. But either way, as borrower, you're coming to the bank and saying, either I'm about to become the owner of this property with your help and your money, or I already own this piece of property. But in either event, I want to borrow $731,000. Okay, and the bank is saying in that letter, okay, I'll loan it to you. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, I was just curious if you wanted to have some leverage, you know, other than like some pre-approval letter that you'd get from a bank.
You can go get a pre-approval letter as to your credit and your ability to borrow.
Yeah, I'm just thinking you want to know that, you know, as long as you've got your X to X loan to value ratio and the property appraisers were supposed to, that they're going to give you a commitment.
That's what
they
call a pre-qualification letter. You're not going to get that in a commercial transaction. Residential, you are. But here's the point. But that's going to be non-specific, as specific as to you, the borrower, but it's non-specific as to the piece of property.
Yeah.
And it's going to say something like, and there, so long as our appraisal says we're not loaning you more than 75% of our appraised value of the property, and so long as we like the piece of property, etc. If you don't already own it, if you do already own it, it's still going to have an appraisal contingency in there. Yes, sir?
How long are these loan commitment letters valid for?
As long as the term, and they're set forth in there. They will have a closing date.
So, I mean,
they're often only 30 days. Sometimes they're as long as 60 days. And let me tell you why. The bank is agreeing there with you what the interest rate is going to be at your closing 45, 60 days out. They're not happy to be deciding today what your rate's going to be next month when rates may go up. That's why, and this is where I was going before we got off, that's why they charge you a commitment fee. When you accept the commitment letter, when you sign it, you both sign it, agree to everything, you send the bank a commitment fee that is often 0.5% of the loan amount. $731,000, you will send them a commitment fee of $3,500, $3,700, something like that. And that's non-refundable, whether you close or don't close, whether you buy the property or don't buy the property, at the end of 30 days, if you haven't closed, that's tough. The bank's philosophy is, we have set aside $731,000 for you. We can't do anything else with it. We've locked it up. And we've locked for you what the rate's going to be for 30 or 45 days. We want to be paid for that. Because if you don't take the loan, keeping your money. And basically, we're keeping your money anyway. Absolutely. You don't get a commitment feedback. You don't get a commitment feedback if it doesn't appraise. It's going to have conditions in their property has to appraise. You don't get it back if it doesn't appraise out. You don't get it back, period. It is your, it, the bank's philosophy is, it's your payment to them for the benefit of them setting aside money for you and locking the rate over. And like any contract, we talked about a contract has to have consideration. That's the consideration for this contract, is the payment of the commitment fee. Now, of course, there's also the promise to loan, there's the promise to borrow. We said promises work as consideration. But for a commercial commitment fee, for a commercial commitment, you're going to pay for it.
So the expiration date can vary. It's like hold on to the letter itself. Rates go up, 10 days later, I'll sign it because I'm still within my period.
They will give you a period of time in there of how long you have to accept it, too. They will say something to you like, this must be accepted by tomorrow, and the loan must close in 45 days. I have both in courage. The day you do accept it, you have to pay the commitment fee.
You float in, and then you actually tell them when you want to lock. We lock the rate for X amount of days.
If they don't lock the rate for you, they tell you the rate will be determined on the day of closing. Sometimes they don't tell you what the rate's going to be. Sometimes they tell you it'll be Citibank Prime plus 3. You'll find out when you get to closing. And then you can pay them an additional fee, a locker rate, and you pay for a certain period. You can rate lock for a certain period, number of days, and then a certain fee. That they have fees for all this kind of crap. But the point is, what you need to understand at this juncture is there is a commitment that is the loan contract between the borrower and the bank. It is a contract, and it is going to have a commitment fee due. But if somebody says to you, what is the document that reflects that you get after a loan application if you get approved? It's a commitment letter. The bank in that letter is committing itself. We hereby commit to loan you $731,000 on the following terms. Now, there are going to be a lot of terms in there. As I told you, these are going to be 7 or 8 pages long, and they're going to be the terms that are going to show up in the loan documents. When you sign the note and mortgage, the commitment letter kind of goes away. It's like a contract. The contract goes away, and we actually do closing documents, just like in our regular transaction. The contract goes away, and we do a deed. Here, the commitment contract goes away, and we're going to have a note and mortgage. But they set up the terms, and that's why all these things get crossed out and changed. In the commitment letter, if the borrower is of sufficient strength to be negotiating with the bank, if you're a little guy and this is your first deal, and you change the to the, they're going to say, go to hell, we're not loaning to you. If you've got clout with the bank, if you deposit your funds there, what a lot of them require is they require you to transfer all your bank accounts to that bank. They want you as their customer. They want your deposits. At a very minimum, they require you to deposit all of the rental income from this piece of property in an account at that bank and to maintain your operating account for this piece of property at that bank. Some bank is not going to make you a loan on this piece of property and let you be having an operating account over at First Union. And they want your business. So that's one of the many things that a commitment letter will require. Okay. Was there enough? Yes, ma'am.
So let's say that this is your first time and you're interested in applying for a mortgage and you're working with a mortgage broker. In this case, you would get the pre-approval letter, then from there you would get the commitment letter, or the commitment letter comes after you are approved?
The commitment letter is only going to come after you have a certain piece of property specified. Pre-approval letter is approving you as the borrower that if you find an acceptable piece of property, we would approve a loan for you. But that's not a commitment letter. A pre-approval letter just says your credit's good, looks like based on your income, we'll be able to loan you $300,000.
So if you already have a said property that you're interested in and you're approaching a mortgage broker that is working with the bank, then in this case, you don't ask them for a pre-approval letter. You ask them straight,
commitment letter.
And that means that you
candidly, candidly, a pre-approval letter is a joke. It just says I got good credit. It's not, not this deal. It's not this day. It's not this rate. It basically says this person's a good customer. Or we'll probably give them a loan.
So you need
but
to.
It doesn't mean anything.
So you need to request a commitment letter,
what
or will they give it to you?
You brought up an interesting term about a mortgage broker, and we're going to talk about mortgage brokers in a minute, what their function is. What I'm talking about is not issued by the mortgage broker. It's issued by the bank, a real, actual lender. Okay, that's a commitment letter. But the mortgage broker ain't loaning you the money. It's the bank that's loaning you the money. The mortgage broker may ask the broker to, you know, connect you to the bank, but you want a commitment letter from the bank who's going to actually fund the loan. Okay, now, there are different rights and obligations of the parties that are set forth in this 39 pages of mortgage. A couple of the basics are that there's no question that the borrower keeps the right to possession. You don't give the bank possession of your property until you default. You don't give the bank your rents until you default. Although the document says you're giving it to them, you don't until you default. In addition, there are two paramount things that the bank is interested in. Forgetting for a moment the payments. They are more interested in the payments than they are on the sun coming up tomorrow. That's the most important thing, make your monthly payments. But there are two more things that are huge to a bank. Number one, making sure you pay your real estate taxes. Why? Anybody?
The government will take it. They got priority.
First lien. The only lien that can get ahead of that recorded mortgage is real estate taxes over here. Because we said it is the highest dignity, highest priority lien anywhere. So the bank wants to be damn sure that you pay the taxes every year, because if you don't, the lien of the governmental authority for the real estate taxes is in front of their mortgage. And we're going to talk about how they make sure of that in a second. But the second thing that they care about is that you pay for your insurance. Why?
If
the building
fire
burns down,
yeah,
their collateral's gone.
Yep.
They want an insurance policy there to put another building back up for them.
As a matter of fact, my bank puts in escrow both the taxes and the insurance.
And that's exactly where I was going with this.
Yeah.
You, the way that the bank covers itself is to make you pay them every month 1/12 of the real estate taxes. And at the end of the year, they take your money and go pay the taxes. And 1/12 of the insurance premiums. And there may be three policies we talked about. There may be a hazard policy, a flood policy, and a windstorm policy. They will charge you 1/12 of each of those every month. These are what are called escrows or reserves. And you hear people say all the time when they talk about what are the payments on the mortgage, what's the PITI? What's my PITI going to be? That's principal and interest. What's my monthly payment for principal and interest on the loan, and my taxes, and my insurance? Because every month you're going to pay to the bank a little bit of principal, a lot of interest, 1/12 of your real estate taxes, 1/12 of your insurance premiums. And when that insurance bill comes due every year, insurance company's going to send the bill to the bank. The bank's going to pay them with your money that you've been paying all year long. So they get up to month 12, and then they have 12/12, and then they make the payments. Yes, sir?
Why is it that when they accrue all of that money in escrow, they don't give us some kind of interest credit?
Because you're not strong enough to negotiate that. I guarantee you, let me say two things. If you're really big, they don't make you escrow at all. Okay? If you're pretty big, you get to negotiate them paying you interest on the escrows, okay? And if you're regular Joe like the rest of us, it's just tough. They keep the money all year long. They say they're doing you a favor by helping you create a savings account to pay your taxes, so it won't be so hard on you in November when the bill comes in. And we're doing a great job of doing the accounting and keeping track of all your money, you know. But they're doing it to make sure these things get paid, because they think they care more about them than you do. But if you're really big, you pay the taxes, you send them the bill every year.
As a matter of fact, they charge more than 1/12 because they usually have a little reserve in there.
Well, and they know that every year they're going to go up a little bit. So often, if your taxes last year were $3,000, they'll recalculate your escrow this year and say, we guess that'll probably be $3,300. We'll charge your escrows based on $3,300 this year. You may have a little left over, you may not. Questions? I'm sorry. Yes. Yes.
Well,
go.
Does the escrow agent or the bank charge you fees on top of that for holding money?
Oh, it's the bank.
So does the bank?
No, there is no escrow agent. There's no third party. You're paying them to the bank, and the bank.
You don't pay fees for escrow money. It's included in the loan that you're going
to. Yeah. The point is, they're not paying them to some third party.
And no, his question was, is the bank holding you or some third party? It's the bank.
No, they don't. No. No, at least they don't assess you fees for the honor of taking your money. But they get your interest on all your money.
Yeah, they got a lot of interest, man.
Their fee is the interest that you're not gaining.
Okay, so. Understand without, there are kind of three levels of concepts here. Without question, the loan documents are going to require the borrower to pay the taxes and the borrower to pay for the insurance. The only question is whether the bank is going to charge you for them every month in advance so they can pay the bills. But at a minimum, they're going to require the borrower to pay and prove to them every year that they pay them. And if you don't, they'll go out and pay them. And then they'll add them to your loan. And they'll charge you a default interest rate on that fact that you didn't pay them. And if we talk about what's a default interest rate, Florida, 24%. And they can do it because the documents say they can do it. We're going to talk about usury in a minute. Not every loan is 24%. We'll talk about that in a second. But the whole concept is that the bank's going to require the borrower to pay the taxes and insurance. And they may further secure that by requiring what's called escrows or reserves. That escrow word goes a lot of places. You know, we have an escrow agent. We have escrow closings and escrow means kind of piling up the money somewhere. And they call those escrows impounds. In California, they call them impounds, I-M-P-O-U-N-D-S. They all mean the same thing. What's the general question? Okay. All right. Now, we're going to talk about priorities for just a minute. Priorities of mortgages, meaning first mortgage, second mortgage, third mortgage, is all about recording, just like we talked about recording. Whoever records first is first. Whoever records second is second. You can have a first mortgage and a second mortgage and a third mortgage on a piece of paper, or a dozen of mortgages, if you can talk the banks into it. Whoever got recorded first is the first, and the second and the third. That makes a lot of difference when you get into a foreclosure that we're going to talk about later. Everybody wants to be in first position. The only person that can get ahead of whoever had the first mortgage, we said, was the government charging real estate taxes. So mortgage priorities are determined by the order of their recording. As to leases versus a recorded mortgage, the general rule is who came first. If the leases were already in place before the mortgage is recorded, the leases are prior to the mortgage. If the leases are entered into after a mortgage is recorded, they're junior to the mortgage. What that's all about is when the lender forecloses the property, is the lender bound by the leases or is the lender not bound by the leases? So we have recording priorities there and timing priorities between leases and mortgages. If that doesn't sound complicated enough, a massive source of litigation is priorities between mortgages and mechanics liens. That is a can of worms like you would just never believe. mechanics liens are always trying to find ways to get in front of mortgages. And construction lenders are always trying to find ways to make sure the mechanics liens are after their mortgage. And what causes the problem is the general body of law that says that any time a mechanics lien is created, its priority relates back to when construction began. Well, God forbid if that construction was before the mortgage, then maybe these mechanics liens get in front of the mortgage. So lenders have two or three different documents to provide that, no, never mind all that. Mechanics liens are after us. In addition, they tell you, you may not begin your construction until we've closed our loan, but everybody does, because you can't wait that long until your damn loan is closed. So there's just mounds of litigation between mechanics lien holders and mortgages, and here's why. When a construction loan goes into default, the deal is blowing up and the bank has taken over the job. Well, all these people who have done work and haven't gotten paid, the bank wants to wipe them all out. And they all want to get paid. So they all butt heads and litigate with each other over who was in front of them. It's a mess. Mm-hmm. That's enough to know that it is a mess. Yes, sir?
You had stated in previous classes that leases all need to be in writing in excess of 1 year, but don't necessarily need to be recorded.
Exactly.
So what's to say that a mortgage gets recorded and there's an unrecorded lease as to the validity of when it got executed?
Here's where it will come about. When the bank takes the property, here's where it all boils down to. When the bank forecloses a mortgage and takes the property back, it's all about, does the bank want to honor the leases, or does the bank want to kick all those people out and put new people in? And that's when it hits the fan. If the bank comes in and says, your lease is no good, you're out, then you bring them a copy that shows that your lease was entered into before their mortgage is entered into, the court will uphold you. If your mortgage is entered, if your lease is entered into after the mortgage is recorded, not to say later when they foreclose and take the property back, then the court's going to say, no, you're out. The mortgage is in front of you. But normally, you're right, we don't record leases, but it's only going to hit the fan when the bank comes in and tries to get rid of tenants. Now, if the leases are good leases and they're at market value, the bank's not going to kick people out. Hell, they'd love to have the income. Otherwise, they've got an empty building, they got to go lease it out. So if it's a good lease, whenever it was entered into, the bank's going to want them there and they're going to want the rent. But if it's a sweetheart lease to the owner's mother-in-law for $1 a year, they're going to want to get rid of it. So it's really all about the market value of the lease. You know, are they at market rate? Yes, sir.
Regardless of priority, though, if a bank is second or third and something happens where they need to protect their interest, would it not be appropriate for them to take out the person who's in front of them, pay them off so that they can exercise their right? Would the court not uphold that?
It's all going to be a decision of economics. And I want to get into examples of that next week when we discuss foreclosures. I'm going to draw you a picture of a piece of property with 7 or 8 liens on it, of all different types, and et cetera, and with 3 mortgages. And we're going to talk about the different competing equities between these guys and what should the guy in third position do? Mm-hmm. Does he want to get wiped out when the first mortgage forecloses? Does he want to step up and buy the first or the second and foreclose himself?
Exactly.
Well, that all turns on what's the property worth, you know? So economics is going to drive all that. Yes, ma'am.
You mentioned that you can have multiple mortgages if
yes.
you can convince the institution to lend you.
Absolutely.
My question is, let's say that...
Unless. Remember, we looked here and it said the first mortgage prohibited you getting a second mortgage. But if it didn't prohibit you, sure, you can get a second mortgage.
So in this case, for the second mortgage, can it be used to cover closing costs if you don't have that amount?
Sure, if the bank will let you get a second mortgage.
But do you need to state to the bank that it's going to be for closing costs, or can you just combine both?
They're not going to just lend you money.
To answer your question, theoretically, yes. But normally, the first lender wants you investing equity into the property so that you give a damn. If they loan you 100%, it's awfully easy for you to walk away when the first payment comes due. When you got 20 or 30% of your own money invested, you're much more likely to make their payment. So they don't want you borrowing that next 20% and having 100% financing.
Mm-hmm.
they loan you 80% and you borrow the 20%, you're in for zip.
I mean, either way, you're going to be putting down payment on it. So in this case, if you just need $7,000 to cover the closing costs, then it's
okay. If the first lender would object.
You ask for a seller credit. You wouldn't want to take out a loan for that.
I
just got a $30,000 seller credit.
Really?
Yeah.
Cool. And
okay.
You just convinced the...
We'll talk about default now.
You sell a big part.
Default. Default means the non-performance of a duty or an obligation set forth in the mortgage documents. Usually it's a missed payment. That's the biggie. That's 99 out of 100 of them. But it can be anything. It can be you didn't pay your taxes. You didn't pay your insurance. You got a second mortgage.
Violation of a term or condition.
Anything. Anything then is 39 pages of provisions that you said you would do and you don't do, that's a default. Here's the importance of a default. Particularly in the case of a missed payment. In your note, you agree to pay $3,000 every month on the first of the month, and you don't make the payment. If you don't make the $3,000 payment, what do you think the bank can do to you?
Foreclose.
Well,
notice.
If it were not for something we're going to talk about, the bank can only sue you for the $3,000 you didn't pay. However, the note and the mortgage are both going to contain an acceleration clause that we looked at earlier. And here's what an acceleration clause does. It accelerates the balance. They no longer do you just owe them the $3,000. You now owe the bank the entire $731,000 right now. This is a hugely important clause to a bank because without it, they'd have to sue you every month for $3,000. And next month for another $3,000, and next month for another $3,000. That's no good. Let's get it over with. Okay, you defaulted. You now owe me the whole balance. I've accelerated what it often, remember the due date on this was 2.5 years away? We've accelerated the due date back to right now. A good way to think of what does that mean? We've accelerated the 30-year due date or the 30-month due date all the way back to right now. You defaulted, you owe me everything. That's an acceleration clause. To the banks, it makes total sense. I see a couple of you shaking your hand like, gee, that isn't fair. Well, it is.
Generally, how many payments do you have to be in default before you accelerate? Three?
Technically, one.
Oh.
What?
But like...
Technically, one. Practically, they won't sue. They won't... There's a lot of steps in the process before
right.
they file a foreclosure. It takes a couple of months to get a foreclosure filed. But now let's go look at it. If you'll forgive me. Oh, go ahead. Your question. We're going to go look back at the acceleration clause now. We're going to see. But go ahead. Yes, sir.
Does that apply to the loan balance at the time? Does that apply to essentially every single payment for the duration of the loan?
Every single remaining payment for the duration of the loan. But no, nobody here. I was going to wait. It doesn't mean if you had a 30-year loan that you now owe them 30 years of interest. It just means you owe the principal balance. The principal. Okay? So in 30 years, you normally pay about 2.5 times the amount of the debt.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't mean you owe 2.5 times the $700,000. But the remainder of the 731 that you haven't paid yet, it's all due right now. Yes, sir.
Yeah, my question is has to deal with the definition of default.
Right.
Like on my own mortgage, I have a 15-day grace to pay the debt, to pay the monthly mortgage.
Can we look at that right now, please? That's where I'm going now. Would you take a look back at the promissory note on page 2, where I told you we're now going to look, that's an acceleration clause, so we're now going to look at one. Now, this is my page 2. I don't know what page this is on for yours. It says,
what's it titled?
Promissory note that we talked about first. The second page, There are two clauses I have that begin each maker. It's the next one. The said principal sum or the unpaid balance thereof shall become due and payable at the option of the holder after default in the payment of any installment of principal and interest for a period of 15 days. That's called the grace period. Some loans have no grace period. Some loans, on the second day of the month, you're in default. But remember, it said here, at the option of the holder. That doesn't mean it automatically comes due on the 16th day, but the lender has the right to accelerate and declare it due on the 16th day. We've got some more to cover, but go ahead.
At which point do they, if you pay on the 20th day and they don't enforce it, at which point do they accept that they're not going to enforce your default and not come 10 months from now and tell you, oh, by the way, you defaulted 10 months ago?
If they have not sent you a notice of acceleration, then they have not accelerated. Let's keep reading. That was it for the default and the payment of any payment of principal or interest for 15 days. Or after the default of any of the performance of any of the covenants or conditions of the first mortgage. There is no 15-day grace on you didn't pay your taxes and you didn't pay your insurance. There's only a 15-day grace on the monthly payments. There is no grace period on other defaults. Goes on. Should the maker fail to pay any installment or principal and interest for 15 days, the maker shall also pay a late charge to the lender of 5% of the amount of the payment that was late. If you pay on the 16th of a month and your payment was $3,000, you owe them another $150. Period. And you send in your payment on the 16th, they'll take your payment. And then they'll send you a notice, you owe us another $150. And if you don't pay the $150, then you've defaulted under the mortgage, and then they'll accelerate the whole damn balance. You kind of need to understand here that the documents are not designed in your benefit. The reason you paid the bank's lawyer $7,000 to protect the bank is so that that lawyer can draft 39 pages of stuff that works for the bank and doesn't work for you. And that's what these documents are all about. This is not the Bill of Rights of the borrower. This is all about what you shall do or else.
And now, my takeaway from that is you got to read and understand, because if I, God forbid, if I'm ever late on the 16th day, I'm going to pay both the monthly payment and the penalty for being late one day, and then that goes away.
And you hope that they didn't accelerate that morning, you know. But now let's back up for a minute and answer your question. Of course they don't foreclose on day 16. They don't want your damn townhouse.
Property.
They want their payment. So they will, but this is nothing you get, nothing you get to take to the bank is what I'm gonna say. This is nothing you get to rely on. You know what your document said, and if you're on the bad side of a loan officer, and you made him mad for some reason, on the 16th, he can send you an acceleration letter.
You can get out of it.
In which case, you can always pay the 731, but they no longer, the day they sent you the acceleration notice, they no longer are required to take your $3,150 payment if they don't want to.
Okay.
They will. They'd much rather have your money than the property. But if for some reason they really want your property, they won't take your payment. They'll send that payment back and say, I'm sorry, no, that's not $3,000. I want $731,000. Give it to me or don't. And then a couple of months later, the sheriff will serve you with a foreclosure summons, and then you're getting foreclosed again. And candidly, I spent a good part of my life as a lender's lawyer. I don't see anything wrong with that. You signed a contract, you agreed to do all these damn things, and you didn't do them. Doesn't bother me, and I wouldn't lose 10 seconds of sleep over that. Because you didn't know what the contract said. Well, I know, I lost my job and I got sick, and
right.
That's fine. But this doesn't say, except if you get sick. So honestly, it's not intended for your benefit. It's intended for the bank.
A judge isn't going to do that if you miss it.
Yes, ma'am. Do you have a question?
So just in the event that you are at the acceleration period and then you do come to terms with the payments, you get yourself completely caught up, do you think is it smart to get a letter like of clearance? Because sometimes I've heard of situations where they continue.
They're not going to give you one. If they're taking your payment every month,
they're
happy as pigs, and you know what? And you should be too. You know, it's all cool. It's when they start sending your payments back, you know, you really put them over the edge. When you wait and try to send them $9,450 because you were 3 months late, you'd think they'd be thrilled to have it. Usually they are. But they may have said, you've done this twice a year for the last 4 years. We're sick and tired of screwing with you. It's not worth $150 a month to put up with her crap. Foreclose the loan. And the bank sends it to the lawyer and says, foreclose it. And the lawyer forecloses it. And all that means is, still you got to pay it off. It's not like, oh my God, I've necessarily lost my house. You can still pay it off. You can't pay $9,000 anymore. You got to pay $731,000. But what we're going to talk about, remember, is
can you refinance in that time period, or is there a time period to refinance really quick?
Well, foreclosure takes a year and a half. You got all the time in the world,
before
you're really
going to
lose a house. But the point is, what we're talking about here is, when do you lose your right to just make up the late payment? When the bank has accelerated and says, I don't want $3,000 anymore. I want to get out of this loan. I'm tired of her. The pain in the neck. She's late every month. I'm sick of it. Not just you. I'm talking about there are bad loans and bad cases and bad borrowers that are just a pain in the ass. And sometimes the bank just says, I've had it. Foreclose it. Make them sell the property. That'll make them sell. That'll make them refinance and take us out. That'll make our life simpler because we don't have to deal with it anymore. So just foreclose it anyway. And the courts will uphold them on that because this clause says they have the right to do it. That's an acceleration clause. It is hugely important to the bank because otherwise they would have to sue every month for the missing monthly payment. Okay, now, however, having heard all of that bad news, here's what I call the good news. Bless you. You have what's called a right of redemption. You have what's called, in general, the concept of equity of redemption. Blank crap, I'm sorry. You have, in general, the right of redemption. And in Florida, you have a specific statutory right of redemption. And what this is all about is you always have the right to go pay the thing off in full. It never means, whoops, they're going to get my house. Because you get to pay them off. You sell the house and the buyer's new pays them off. Or you go get a refinance, except your credit's already screwed, you're not going to get another loan. But theoretically, grandma could loan you the money and you go pay them off. The point is, you don't automatically lose your property. Right up until, and there's the statutory right of redemption I want to tell you about. We're going to talk about foreclosures next week. But the drift of a foreclosure is, ultimately, the court is going to have a sale of your property. It's going to have an auction. And for 10 days after the auction, even, you got 10 more days after the auction to come into court and still pay the whole thing off. In Florida, that's called your statutory right of redemption. Now, you don't get to come in with your $3,000 anymore. You come in with your $731,000, your $20,000 or $30,000 worth of foreclosure expenses, the attorney's fees, and by now your balance is $800,000. But you still got the right to pay it and save your property. That's called your right of redemption. Not your right to get back to, damn, I'm sorry, can I be $3,000 a month anymore? No, that's over. But your right to pay off the loan before you lose the property. That's called the right of redemption. To me, that's, theoretically, that's a sufficient backdrop. Not an easy burden, but But compared to everybody says I'm losing my house, you're not necessarily losing your house. Pay it off. Get the money out of your IRA and take the tax hit, borrow it from grandma, do something, but you get to pay the damn thing off before you lose the property. Okay, that's called a right of redemption. And in Florida, it's for 10 days even after the auction, up until what's called the certificate of title is issued. Remember we looked at all those deeds? One of those documents was a certificate of title. That's where the clerk actually deeds the property to the guy who bought it at the auction. And that's 10 days after the guy bought it at the auction. And the purpose of that 10 days is to give you 10 more days to try to pay it off. Yes, sir?
Can you buy your own property at an auction for a discount rate?
Uh-huh.
All right.
Can you? Did you say?
Yeah.
Oh, sure.
All right, so instead of paying $700,000, let's say someone auctions it out for like $200,000, you can pay up $200,000.
Yeah.
But the bank is against you.
You better be real sure they did the foreclosure right. Number one. And number two, you better be real sure that wasn't a foreclosure of a third mortgage. Because it's not going to say that. It's not going to say, hey, look out, this is a third mortgage. That's on you. So you go in and pay $200,000 for the at an auction sale of a foreclosed property, and you think that's really a bargain? Yeah, except there's $1 million first mortgage and $500,000 second mortgage. And those are on you. So yeah, you can get some real bargains at foreclosures, and there are guys, just like these guys that buy tax sale certificates. I mean, they're hounds that sit around and read this stuff and look at appraisal, go to sales. We now no longer have the auction on the steps of the courthouse like we used to. They're all online, so it's like eBay. You see this guy bid, you want to outbid him, But the point is, but you don't, unless you're good, you don't know what you're buying. You might be buying at a foreclosure sale of a third mortgage and not even know it, that there was a first and a second. So you got to go examine the title.
Yeah, but I'm saying if it's your own property, like you take out a loan, you buy a property, and then foreclose on it.
Yeah.
And you buy it on the foreclosed.
Can you yourself buy it on the foreclosure?
Yeah.
Of course, we'll not want it.
All right.
The same name? No.
Absolutely not. You can't, the purchaser is not allowed to be a bidder at the foreclosure.
You're not even a short sell.
Bid him out, I'll do it for 5 seconds.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Can you yourself buy it? The purchaser is not allowed to bid. Okay,
you
now.
Pay off the. Can I make a comment?
I want to talk through the concepts of foreclosure for a minute. But I'm not going to go through the steps until next week. But I want to talk about the three theories of foreclosure. There are three ways to foreclose a mortgage. And in Florida, we, if you would imagine, only have one of those three. The first one, I'm changing the order on these, is the non-judicial foreclosure, because that's the simplest. It's not the simplest, but it may be the simplest to understand. We don't have this in Florida. A non-judicial foreclosure allows the lender to sell the property without a court proceeding. Imagine that. The name makes sense. Non-judicial. Yes, sir.
Does that go back to the lien theories that you were talking about?
No. Even with lien theory, in some states...
Even if they don't hold title, they can still sell.
Exactly. They can. Yeah. In some states, the lender has the right to sell the property upon a default in a public or private sale without going to court. That's called non-judicial foreclosure. Okay. The opposite of non-judicial foreclosure is, anybody?
Judicial
foreclosure. Okay. Yeah, you gotta go to court. That's what we have in Florida. We have only judicial foreclosures in Florida, period. There is no way to foreclose a mortgage without a court proceeding in Florida by statute, by law. And that means the lender has to file a foreclosure lawsuit in the court, and the court's going to sell the property. That's judicial foreclosure. Now, there's one other thing that is so arcane and archaic that we don't even talk about it, but the materials mention it, and that's called strict foreclosure.
Strict?
And strict foreclosure is simply the lender gets your property, period. There is no sale at all. That's unheard of under our law. Or we say, well, you have a lien. The lien means it gets to be a sale. And in both cases, we talked about you have a lien and there needs to be a sale. In the non-judicial case, the sale is without the court. In the judicial case, the sale is by the court. But a strict foreclosure is, lender just takes your house, period, and there's no sale at all, in exchange for having a mortgage. You said, you give me your house if you didn't pay me? Great, give me your house.
And that would be a statutory requirement, not a term and condition in the mortgage agreement.
Well, that is it would be a state that allows that procedure. We just don't.
So
we absolutely prohibit it.
But don't they sell it like later on?
And they go, sure, they don't want your house.
Right.
Yeah, they're going to sell. But they don't have a sale in order to take the property away from you. They take the property, the lender, Bank of America becomes the title holder.
Okay?
In these other foreclosure proceedings, the bank never becomes the title holder. They just see that there's a sale and somebody else is gonna buy it and they get the money. In a strict foreclosure, the bank would actually become the title holder.
Okay.
That just doesn't happen in Florida. Now.
Question.
Yes, sir, I'm sorry.
Is that, that sounds like the new modern day deed in lieu.
We're going to talk about it next.
Oh, okay.
Next topic is, okay. So we've got foreclosure. What are the alternatives to foreclosure?
Are we talking about deficiencies or no?
Did you say deficiencies? Not yet.
Not yet.
Okay, not yet. But we will. Okay. The alternative, there are two ways. Okay, things are going badly. Property value has gone down. There are two other things the bank can do in lieu of foreclosure. In lieu of means instead of, right? So in lieu of, L-I-E-U, in lieu of foreclosure, alternatives to foreclosure. The first is called a deed in lieu of foreclosure. This is simply deed the property to the bank. Borrower conveys the property back to the bank. Bank agrees to accept the deed in satisfaction of the debt. That's called a deed in lieu of foreclosure. Yes, sir.
That does not affect the credit?
I don't know.
Well, there's no negative impact.
There should be no negative impact in the sense, but realize that you've already missed a bunch of payments. This only happens when the loan is really in default and they said, give me the $700,000. Basically, you're saying, well, can I just deed you the property? How about if I just deed you the property? Would that make you happy? And then don't sue me and don't go through all this foreclosure crap. I'll just deed you the property. That's called a deed in lieu of foreclosure. Now, whether or not your credit is already down the tube because you didn't make payment for 6 months and they've been reporting that, I just don't.
But you'll be able to reapply for financing outside of the guidelines that are usually there.
It's better than having an actually completed foreclosure lawsuit. Yes, it looks better. You made peace with the bank declared the debt was paid, but still it's pretty clear to everybody that you didn't make payments for a while and that's why we got into the situation.
Could you rent it back from the bank?
No.
Could you what?
Rent.
No, they've had it with you, believe
me. They're not property managers.
If you didn't make the mortgage payments, why should they trust you to pay the rent? You know? Okay, now. But this is a limited situation. You got to think about it. And you'll understand this better when I map out the foreclosure mess to you. We're going to talk some more about the alternative foreclosure. But the title has to be clear of other issues. Here's what I'm getting at. If you've got three tax liens against you, and you've got mechanics liens and judgments, You can't deed it back to the bank because all those things are still on there. So the only time a deed in lieu of foreclosure works is if there is no other debt on the property. So it's limited. And realistically, what we're talking about, if you get in trouble and quit making your payments, you probably got lots of other problems too. You got other people suing you, and maybe unpaid taxes and tax liens and judgments and stuff like that. So you may or may not be able to do a deed in lieu of foreclosure. Because if the title isn't clear, the only way to clear it up is going to be to complete a foreclosure and wipe out all those things. Okay. There's another thing that you can do. This is called, yes.
Short sale.
I'm sorry? Yeah, called a short sale. Here's what a short sale is about. You owe the bank $300,000. Property is only worth $200,000. If the bank takes it back and sells it, they're not going to get more than $200,000. It's what it's worth, right? So you go to the bank and say, hey, the best buyer that I can come up with will only pay $200,000. And bank, if you'll just think for a minute, you'll realize you ain't going to get any more than $200,000 either. So why don't we agree that I'll sell to this guy who paid $200,000. Bank, you'll go ahead and accept the $200,000 and let him buy it. It's called a short sale. You are selling the property for an amount that is short of the amount that is due, but the bank's got to agree. In both of these cases, the bank's got to agree, obviously. There are alternatives to foreclosure. You're going to have to reach an agreement with the bank. Either, bank, will you accept a deed in lieu and agree that I paid you, or will you let me sell for what's called a short figure, a short sale? And in both cases, you always have to be thinking about, am I or am I not fully discharging my obligation to the bank? Mm-hmm. And that's a concept that relates to a deficiency. The term is deficiency that we'll talk about in a few minutes. But you always need to be mindful of here in these situations is the bank giving me a release? If I owed them $300 and they agree, let's sell it for $200, they'll take $200, do I still owe them another $100 or don't I? Well, sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. You got to be damn sure, and you want to see on paper that it will be in full satisfaction of your debt. Even in the deed in lieu of foreclosure situation, you want to be sure that once they accept your deed, and people talk about giving the bank the keys, you give the keys. You know, in a short sale you don't, you're selling to somebody else, but in a deed in lieu, you're deeding the property to the bank. People talk about leaving the keys on the table for the bank and walking away. But the question is, remember, you signed a note for $731,000. They may or may not consider this debt forgiven. They may follow you to Oklahoma and sue you for the difference. Maybe, maybe not. You gotta make sure you're covered. Yes, sir.
I would assume that you make sure you get covered by some type of release lien document.
Exactly. There'll be a letter agreement with them. There'll be a release, a satisfaction.
So like in construction mechanics liens, when we make payments out to subs, we require release of lien.
Absolutely.
Mechanic lien. They give you the same thing, but for...
It could name it 20 different things. The whole point is the debt canceled and forgiven.
They put on it final, and they reference the mortgage.
Here's the bummer that you've got to realize on all these things. The flip side of a release sounds wonderful. But, except in a residential situation of your home, in a commercial situation, if you get a forgiveness of a portion of the debt, if they, in a commercial situation, agree to let you sell for $200,000, and to forgive that other $100,000, that forgiveness, according to IRS, is income. You just received $100,000 of income, and you got to pay taxes on it. In a residential situation, it doesn't apply. In a commercial situation, IRS will tax you. So forgiveness of debt, and this is wonderful, beats the hell out of paying that other $100. I'd rather pay the taxes on the $100 than pay the $100, but it still ain't all that free. Okay, those are alternatives to foreclosure. deed in lieu of foreclosure or short sale, we're going to talk about when we map out a foreclosure, when it'll work and when it won't work. And all that's going to be dictated by economics. Again, it's all about what is the property worth now. You know, if the property is worth a lot more, the bank is thrilled to take the property back and they can sell it. If the bank is worth less and they think you're hiding the money in Tahiti, then they're going to follow you to Tahiti and try to get the rest. It's all economics. Okay, now, we're going to talk about a bunch of different types of mortgages. I want you to remember that in every one of these cases, which is very different from each other, you're always going to have a promissory note, which is a promise to pay, and you're always going to have a mortgage that creates a lien on real estate to secure the payment of the note. Because these are all uniquely very different from each other, but you still use a note and a mortgage to get there. The first is called a purchase money mortgage. And that means two different things. Any loan with which the proceeds are used to acquire the collateral is technically a purchase money mortgage. If the proceeds of the loan are used to help pay the seller for the purchase of the property, makes sense? That's a purchase money mortgage. But here's what it usually means. Purchase money mortgage used in the vernacular is a mortgage back to the seller. That's what most people think when you say purchase money mortgage. Any purchase money mortgage means part of the purchase price. It helps you buy. But the term has 9 times out of 10 means a mortgage back to the seller. Now here's what that means. Seller agrees to sell you the property for $400,000. He agrees to take $100,000 in cash, and you sign a note and a mortgage back to the seller for $300,000. You don't have a bank. You don't have a new go to a lender and buy a commitment and all that crud. That's called giving paper back to the seller. Instead of giving him $300,000, you give him paper. Seller is agreeing to finance the deal. That's called a purchase money mortgage. 99 times out of 100 is the seller, but really any loan where the proceeds are used to help pay the purchase price is a purchase money mortgage. And that's contrasted with you already own the property. You could go get a mortgage. That's called a refinance. But if you're using the money to buy the property as a purchase money mortgage, and usually that's a mortgage to the seller. Now here's another kind of mortgage, a construction mortgage. In a construction mortgage, you already own the property. And you come to the bank, meaning none of the money you're borrowing is going to the seller. You already own the property. And you come to the bank and say, I'd like to either improve my improvements, add a second story, add a room on the back of my building, or it's vacant land, I'd like to build a whole new building. That's a construction mortgage, because you're going to use the proceeds for construction. But here's how they work. They are dispersed in stages of completion. They don't hand you $100,000 and say, good luck with your project. They pay in stages of completion, and they pay the contractor, and or they pay the subs, depending on notices to owner and liens and all this crud. They have a construction loan agreement with your contractor, and your contractor becomes a party to the loan. Your contractor is not liable for the loan, but he becomes a party because he's involved in all the disbursements to make sure the work gets done and the subs get paid, etc. That's a construction mortgage. The money's not going to you, the borrower. It's not going to you, the seller. is going into construction. Yes, sir.
So that's different from a bank draw?
Different what?
That's different from a draw?
Well, each of those payments is called a draw. Each time the bank makes a payment, that's called a draw.
And the draw is validated by proper payments that the contractor made, correct?
Exactly. The contractor's come in and prove that he's paid the subs and all right. that stuff, and the bank's going to send an inspector out there to make
send
sure that, yep, whatever stage of completion was required, you know, they may say we'll pay 20% of the proceeds when the slab is done. So the banks are going to come out and see the slab is done. They're going to want the architect to certify the slab was done properly. They're going to want the general contractor to certify that he paid all the subs. And then they're going to make the check payable, believe it or not, to you, the borrower, and the contractor to make sure you're happy with it. So you have to endorse the back of the check when it goes to the contractor. That means you're happy with it with the slab, too. But that's and the, each time they make a payment is called a draw. At a minimum, there are usually four or five of them. And on a huge project, in a 20-story building, there could be 20 of them. They may do one every time they finish a floor, you know?
So it's similar to interest only.
Normally, the borrower pays interest only during the construction period based on what's been dispersed so far.
Right.
They paid out $1 million in the first draw, I pay interest every month on the bank. Next draw, another $1 million, I pay interest every month on 2 million. The loan gets bigger and bigger and bigger until the building is finished. And then you usually normally go get a permanent loan after that. In other words, let's say you've dispersed all 20 million because they built all 20 floors. You pay interest only for a few months, but the bank expects you then to take them out. Go get an insurance company to loan you $30 million to pay them back your 20 and put some in there. Yes, ma'am.
I forget, like if you walk away from the deal in the middle of construction, how do they, if they've already dispersed a certain amount, like if you just walk away, you don't pay anymore, how does that get absorbed?
It gets really ugly.
Yeah, right.
The bank forecloses the mortgage and tries to take over the job. In the construction loan agreement, the contractor, who has walked off the job because nobody's paying him, agrees that if the bank becomes the owner, he'll come back in and finish the job and then get paid by the bank. Because the bank wants to know that building's going to get built. You know, the biggest nightmare in the whole world is when the bank forecloses and just the walls are up and the roof isn't even on yet. And the subs have all filed liens and it's just a nightmare. And that's what they try to prevent. By every month, coming and seeing what you're building, looking at your releases from your subs, looking at who's filed notice to owner, who's filed claims of lien. I mean, the bank has a whole department. It's all over your job.
They base the loan based on a finished product or what you need to actually finish the product. Yeah. Like, how do they?
The contractor has a contract price. He'll build the building for 20 million. So the bank's not going to loan you any more than that 20 for sure. But if they're going to loan you 20, they got to believe that once it's built, it's going to be worth 25.
That's about that.
Because you own the land already when you came into it free and clear. You don't get to come in with a mortgage on your land and say, oh, I'd like a construction loan now. Construction loan is like, I've never seen a construction loan that wasn't a first mortgage. They require that if you had a mortgage on the land when you came in there, pay that off yourself. They want to have a first lien on your free and clear land in order to justify all the money they're going to put into building the building. That's a construction loan. But there's a note, there's a mortgage, but in addition, there's a construction loan agreement, there may be bonds, there may be all kinds of stuff going on. They get infinitely complicated, but still, it was a note and mortgage. But you signed a $20 million note, even though they haven't dispersed a penny yet. Because they're saying, when you get the first floor in, we'll give you the first million. We'll give it to you and the contractor, and you guys, and we'll start talking about the second floor.
But in her scenario, though, a bonding company would chime in and
if you had a completion bond, yes, a performance bond, the bonding company will come in and finish the job, sure.
Yeah. 30 days.
There are all kinds of people supervising all this stuff to make sure it gets done. The bigger the job, the more supers. The bonding company has an architect who's certifying the work is done. The owner has his own architect certifying the work is done. The contractor, of course, says, oh yeah, the work is done, but somebody else, a lot of people are making sure it is, and making sure the work is done properly, number one, secondly, in accordance with the plans and specs, and thirdly, that the subs all get paid. Okay, that's a construction loan. We have what's called an open-end mortgage. An open-end mortgage. That's kind of like your home equity line of credit or something. It's a line. The point is, it allows the borrower to make draws later, whenever the borrower wants them, not just based on construction, up to a certain amount. So in that case, you go into the bank and you sign a $300,000 mortgage. But they don't give you any money. They give you a checkbook, start making draws. They give you a credit card, use a credit card. They all pile up on this open-ended mortgage and the balance goes up. It's an open-ended mortgage. In addition, the mortgage that we looked at, some people would call an open-ended mortgage. You remember it said the loan on the first page was for $731,000? But it said the borrower can get future advances up to $3 million.
Right.
The difference between the $731,000 and the $3 million is called open-end, meaning their future advances. The point is, anytime the loan can get bigger, the amount due can get bigger and bigger, up to a certain amount, that's called an open-ended mortgage. It's open-end, it's open, but it's capped. And there's always an amount on there. You don't get to draw $20 million on your house. Based on their appraisal value of how much equity do you have and how much will they let you draw. And then they cap it at a certain point. You pay them interest only every month, or you pay them interest in principal every month, just like you do on a credit card. But sometimes it's accessed with a credit card, sometimes it's accessed with a checkbook, and sometimes it's accessed with call your guy and say, hey, would you put $3,000 in my account?
So
you know, access however you set up with the bank.
So you say that's based off the equity of the property?
Oh, sure. Based upon how much equity they think you have in the property. And they don't want to advance any more than that.
Yeah, it's got to be secure.
And that's open-ended. It just means the amount isn't determined. There's another type that I want you to be a little bit aware of, just because you might hear the term. And it's a little bit complicated, but you'll probably never run into one, and it's called a wraparound mortgage. Wraparounds are weird. What it means is, a wraparound mortgage is at least, it's never a first mortgage. It's a second mortgage, or a third mortgage, or a fourth mortgage, or whatever. All it means simply is the lender on the wraparound mortgage agrees that he, the lender, will make the payments on the prior mortgages. That's the difference. You already had a first mortgage and you've been paying on it. You go get a wraparound second mortgage and you only have to make the payments on the second wraparound. He makes the payments on the first. Now this sounds really silly. It used to happen a lot when that first mortgage couldn't be transferred. And sellers often take wraparound mortgages. The seller may have a 3% first mortgage and he really doesn't want to pay it off because that's so damn cheap. He'd rather do a wraparound second with you at 6% and then he'll make the payments on the 3% mortgage. So, the point is, the size of the wraparound mortgage will include the amount of the first. If you, in our case, had a $300,000 first mortgage and you wanted to borrow $100,000, you'd give a wraparound second for somebody for $400,000. Because it included the amount of the first. So you make payments to him based on $400,000. And it's up to him out of those payments to keep the current on the $300,000. Doesn't happen very often. It wraps around a prior mortgage.
Can you get some equity?
Sure, if the property was worth $500,000, you got some equity. You know, if the property was worth $250,000, nobody would be giving you that loan. You know, you're probably never going to see one, but it's a junior mortgage, second, third, fourth mortgage, that wraps around all the prior mortgages. And that lender makes the payments. Now, the materials now I want to talk about what they call different types of loan products. And this is all kind of bunk, and this changes on a daily basis. But they want to talk about fixed rate mortgages, and I think that's what everybody knows what that is.
So you're skipping package mortgage?
I'm sorry?
You're skipping package mortgage?
I sure am.
There's a bunch of other ones there, so you're skipping everything you don't talk about, right?
I'm not going to talk about it.
Yeah.
We didn't talk about it. You don't have to know it. All right, fixed rate mortgage. A fixed rate mortgage is the traditional fixed interest rate fixed term fully amortized loan. What that simply means is, this is the 15, 20, 25, 30-year mortgage that you hear about all the time, where there's a fixed interest rate. That's why they call it a fixed rate mortgage, by the way. The interest rate is fixed, and you're going to make payments every month. Most of that payment is interest, and a little bit is principal, so that the loan is fully amortized over whatever the term is, fully paid off. At the end of 15 years, you pay the whole thing off. If the same, take the same size loan, if you're going to get a fixed rate mortgage to pay it off in 15 years, the payments are going to be a hell of a lot bigger than if you got a fixed rate loan to pay it off in 30 years. They got to be bigger. How are we going to get rid of this thing in 15 years? It's going to take a bigger payment every month than it would take to pay it over 30 years. Frankly, this is what most people think a mortgage is. Then there are adjustable rate mortgages. That's where the rate changes and the payment changes. That's why they call it an adjustable rate mortgage. The rate is adjustable. What that means is simply the way these work in a residential setting, and they can work any way in the world in a commercial setting, but is simply the rate is based on an index, like we talked about Citibank Prime, but it can be based on LIBOR, which is the London rate. It can be based on all kinds of rates, the Fed exchange rate, the one-year T-bills, the two-year T-bills, the five-year T-bill, whatever the index is, and then there'll be a margin, which is the amount above that index, and every few years that rate will change, and your payment will change. And in a residential loan, they usually have caps. They'll say something like, the interest rate can only go up 2% a year, and over the whole term of the loan, never more than 5% increases. So it just kind of like stops on them, that they can't get any worse than. Those are adjustable rate loans. The one that is probably new to you, though, that I want you to understand and is very important in Florida, is what is a balloon mortgage? The definition in the book is the worst I have ever seen. It doesn't even make any sense. A balloon mortgage is any mortgage that isn't fully amortized. It's any mortgage where the payment at the back end is big. Balloon. The mortgage balloons in 3 years. It balloons in 7 years. And all that means is simply, you made a regular payment. It wasn't big enough to be amortizing the loan over the 7 years. And at the end of 7 years, boom, it's all due. Balloons. Florida's definition is so specific that it says that any payment where the final payment is more than double the amount of the regular prior payments is a balloon mortgage. And here's the interesting thing about Florida law. Florida law says when it is a balloon mortgage, you got to put a big old legend in type like this, big type that says, this is a balloon mortgage. And the final payment is more than double the amount of the prior payments. And your balloon is due on that day. Here's the killer for the lender. If the lender doesn't put that legend in a balloon mortgage, then it doesn't balloon. And the buyer gets to keep making his little bitty payment for 75 years until he's finally paid the damn thing off. Now, Florida has certain exceptions. We don't use it for an interest-only mortgage. We don't use it for a mortgage back to a seller. But basically, you need to be aware that if you get involved in financing where there's a big payment coming at a certain date, that's called a balloon mortgage, and you just have to put a legend in there, right in the statute. Tells you the size of type, tells you what it's got to say, but there are exceptions. If you sell a property and take a mortgage back as a seller, you don't have to put the legend. But if you go get a mortgage from a third party, at the bank or whatever, and it says they got to have a legend, that's all it is. But it can be huge because without the legend, the guy gets to just keep making his payments. And what the book talks about is all about the guy makes a little bitty payment that's smaller than the amount, and what it's all about is, boom, you got a balloon at a certain date in the future, and it's gonna be big. It'll be a lot bigger than you're paying for. Yes, sir.
Are you working with Clayman to produce a ninth edition that is correct?
Would you say that again?
Are you working with Clayman to produce a ninth edition, which is correct?
No, I'm not. Professor Clayman would never listen to me, I assure you. But I kept reading that definition and thought, what the hell is he talking about? Yes, ma'am.
When it comes to an ARM mortgage, what would that fall under?
ARM is an abbreviation for an adjustable rate mortgage. All right, there's another type of mortgage I want you to know about. It's called a reverse mortgage. You see ads on TV. Senator Fred Thompson used to do ads, but now he did. A reverse mortgage that's also called a reverse annuity mortgage also has a pretty lousy definition, because they don't mention the most important thing about it. The important thing about it is there are no payments due. The borrower doesn't make any payments. When the borrower dies, it all becomes due. A reverse mortgage, and sometimes called an annuity mortgage, and I'll tell you why the word annuity in there, is designed and federally regulated now. And they're getting more and more attractive, and now all these financial advisors are coming out and say, great idea for the baby boomer generation that didn't save enough money, that does not have any money for retirement. Simply, let's say you own a $300,000 home, free and clear, you own all the equity, you own it free and clear, you don't owe anybody anything. But that doesn't exactly buy your groceries. You still got to have income every month, and if you don't have enough income, you can go to a lender and say, I'd like a reverse mortgage, where a lender, you send me a check every month for 50